Hi, praise the Lord, everyone. We come at you again with another exciting and insightful episode of Anchor Hour. My name is Eunice, and we're continuing on our discussion on the topic, making a choice and the challenge of expectations in marriage. If you joined us last week, then you probably listened to the introductory part. And so today we are bringing you the second part. And my facilitator, as always, has been Overseer Professor Joseph Osafo Edu, who is the resident minister here at RWC, a wing of the Church of Pentecost International. And he's also the head of the counseling division of the church and an avid researcher into matters of psychology and life issues. You're welcome, Papa. It's always good to have you. So we had an intense discussion last week about, you know, choices, the expectations in marriage, and you taught us what choices were, the expectations, what to look out for, and all of that. But then a lot of the questions that came were, are expectations necessary in the dating stage?
That's a very good question. All right. And good afternoon to you, cherished listeners. We want to just celebrate God for your life, that you have been following this, and I know that lives are being changed and transformed. God bless you. So, are expectations important at the dating stage? Yes and no. So let me address the yes. Yes, because you are going into a relationship with someone, potentially a marital one, that is going to that has the potential to either make or make you, break or build you for the better or for the worse. And so definitely there should be some expectations there, that I'm going into a relationship with someone, and I'm hoping that I'll be a better person. I'm hoping that whatever I want to be able to do, I'm able to do it. I'm hoping that in this relationship, my spouse to be is going to help me build certain areas of my life. I have goals I want to achieve. It's not going to be a goal blocker. It's not going to block me from achieving my goals, but it's going to just encourage me. So there are certain expectations that should be natural. Okay. But no, because sometimes we bring into the relationship certain expectations that have the potential to, if you like, affect the quality of relationship that we are going to nurture and grow when we marry. For example, somebody got into this dating and is expecting the partner to get me, I need an iPhone Pro Max, I need a place to stay, I need to change my hairstyle, I need to change my wardrobe. Completely wrong. You are in the relationship for something that is completely absurd. It's not part of the important factors that should cause you to, the important factors that should drive the success of the marriage. And so you are actually focusing on or majoring on the minus. See, if your partner decides that he wants to bless your life, and even that we'll talk about it, bless your life by giving you a few things, one of the things that we should never lose sight of is never to materialize your love. In other words, don't love because of certain materials. I love him because I got this, I got that, I got that. You're completely wrong. So, yes, have expectations, but have realistic and redemptive expectations. Expectations that are likely to help you grow to become a better person in life and not to be and then flaunting, you know, what you have here and there People should look at the phone you are holding, the car you are driving, the house you are living in, the hair, how do you call that? The wig you are wearing, and all of those. Those are not important.
Okay, awesome. So, you know, we've looked at people at the dating stage. Let's look at managing expectations in marriage. And so I'm gonna merge two questions into one. How do I manage my expectations once I'm married to this person? And secondly, how do I communicate my displeasure or my underwhelmment, so to speak, once I have entered a marriage and my expectations are not met? How do I communicate to my partner in a way that they do not feel unappreciated or offended?
Thank you very much. So let's look at the first one. How do I manage my expectations? Okay. Now, the first principle is to manage surprises. See, people get into marriage and then they will say, I'm shocked that my partner did this against me. Now, and get me right, I'm not saying get into the relationship and then your partner start abusing you and you say, well, it's normal to be abused in marriage. Please, it's not normal to be abused in marriage. And if you are in abusive marriage, it is abnormal. That should be stated categorically and clearly. But sometimes we are caught up into what we call catastrophizing and over elaboration. So for example, in the relationship, somebody, your partner didn't manage certain words and used some words on you. Maybe snubbed you when you were talking, walked on you, didn't care about what you said, disrespected you. And I'm gonna be cautious here. That is not something that is too bizarre, that it doesn't happen in a relationship. It's not true. It does. When people are frustrated in a relationship, they may, in quote, misbehave. And when your partner misbehaves and it's not a consistent misbehavior, you must manage your expectations. And don't be surprised that, so John walked out of me. So Ajua disrespected me. I can't believe it. This cannot happen. No, please, it does happen. So, it does happen. Please manage surprises. Now, when you are surprised, you got in there and there are a few things. Oh, what's happening here? Manage it. The other thing is that you are into a relationship to grow the relationship. You must never get into a relationship and think that the relationship is already mature, is already grown. And so you have gotten in and it's cooked. So let's enjoy, let's eat it, let's make merry. Please, you are into a relationship to grow the relationship. So one of the ways of managing expectation is to be ready to learn and to grow. We call it the growth mindset. Get a growth mindset, not a mindset that is completely closed. Your mind must be open and say, I want to work on this relationship. I want to work together with my partner and achieve what we want to achieve. By this time, you might have discussed a few things with your partner. You know where your partner is heading towards. Your partner knows where you are heading towards. Both of you have a goal. You have a purpose and you are pursuing this purpose. So if you enter into the marriage without a growth mindset, you aren't there to manage expectations. Don't think that I have achieved everything. And some men will enter into the marriage and they think that their wives need to learn and not be. No, but she came in to marry. She has to learn. She's living in my house. She has to learn. You're completely wrong. You and your partner are beginning a life, a journey that you have never been, you've never embarked on. If you have, for example, been married, is the more reason why you need to even learn, because you are bringing somebody on board. So that's the second principle. Open up your mind, growth mindset, and I'm in there to let this grow. The second and the third principle is to manage competition and comparison. Wow. You know, there's nothing wrong in getting a bit competitive in life. Right. Competition drives you to question your own self and question your own mediocrity and push yourself a little bit and say, listen, I need to stretch a little bit. So competition is not all that bad. It's okay. But the problem with competition that is bad is that you are likely to forget that perhaps you are where you are because of the way you think and you look at issues. And that if you want to get to the next step, then you have to lift up the game. So don't get in there and then start comparing. Look, I haven't gotten there. I haven't gotten there. Look at my other partner. They married 2 years and then they have gotten it. But you may not know what they are doing. They may be going one extra mile than you are doing. Right. When you get up in the morning, you want to build a life around a salary. So you are waiting until the end of the month to get a meager salary and plan with it. But the other couple, they beyond their salary, they are doing something else. So don't compare. The other thing why you shouldn't compare is that, you see, life flows in different stages. And also, that there are variations in the way people relate to the experiences they go through in life. I know a couple that went through very demeaning and damaging experience, and yet they turn that experience around for their good. I am also very much informed by a couple. They went through a sort of experience, and they refused to grow up out of that. So the experience broke them completely. If you want to get into the marriage and marriage expectations, then compare your own self with your own future. Where do you want to be? I want to be at point 10. I'm currently at point 4. I need to stretch. Simple. If you want to compare yourself to the other couple, then it's better to listen to what they are doing and the good things they are doing, not the worst, not the bad things they are doing. Because some couples may be doing some kind of questionable businesses to get them to where they are. Maybe engage in other behaviors that make them get what they are getting. Find out first. If you are not very convinced about what you are doing, please be careful about comparison. And this is where a lot of young ladies are caught up in this. You know, they ask their partners, you know, I've been in this marriage for 4 years and I'm not seeing anything happening. Look, my friend married just a few years ago. I've been married to you for about 7 years. We don't have a house. We are still renting. Blah, 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 blah. But the question you should ask yourself is, what is your contribution towards that?
This is for the lady?
Yes, it's for the lady. What are you doing? Are you advising well? Are you also contributing to what is happening at home? Are you having a conversation with your partner? Are you discussing things with him? What is your contribution? You do not complain when you don't contribute.
Wow.
And we must have that as clear. If you contribute, you have the justification to be complaining. Now look, I'm contributing. And I'm contributing intellectually, conversationally, psychologically, financially. And I want to see us move to the next level. If you don't, you have no business querying and complaining, and we are not moving forward. Your partner alone cannot move forward. Otherwise, you become a baggage. You must move together. If he's moving forward and you're a baggage, it's difficult dragging you and carrying you along. But if you are moving together, and the Bible says that, how can two work together except they agree? You know. So that is the third principle, that don't compare. So get in the marriage and then don't compare. Move at your own pace, which is the fourth principle. Now, to move at your own pace simply means that there are some people who don't care how much they get in life or what they have. They are not bothered about material wealth, about opening new doors, growth, and whatnot. They are simply satisfied with life. There is a sense of equanimity with nature and with themselves. Life should be taken cool. If you're that type, that's fine. So, and it helps you manage your expectations in life because you're not competing with anybody. You are just competing with yourself. You are taking whatever is happening one step at a time. And it's as simple as that. So be satisfied with yourself. Be who you are. Be yourself. I got into this marriage and I had a Nissan Micra. And a Nissan Micra can just transport me from where I am to where I work. I can commute. I'm okay. I'll wait until I have 3 or 4 kids when I need a bigger car. Then I'll go in for it. So there are people who are not very competitive in life at all.
And you wouldn't call that complacency?
No, that's not complacency. As long as they are okay with themselves. You see, and they are okay, their partners are okay, and it's fine with them. That's okay. We should come to a place in life not to see the need to move to the next phase of life as so important such that when people have not moved on, we think that they're not growing. Because growth, remember, gift units must not be built on the it must not be built on the altar of material wealth. We don't say people are growing because they have gotten A, B, C. In fact, growth must be measured in terms of maturity, emotional maturity, psychological maturity. It must be measured in terms of interpersonal maturity. All other things that come your way can be added to it. So these are some of the principles of managing your expectations in your marriage and relationship.
Wow. So before you tackle the next phase, if you're joining us, we are speaking on the subject, choices and the challenge of expectations in marriage. So Prof, now I'm in the marriage. I had these expectations. I had wild expectations. And now I am underwhelmed because my expectations are not being met the way I wanted them to, you know. And I don't know how to communicate to my partner about them, you know, in a way that they do not feel, you know, or offended or, you know, unappreciated. How do I do it both ways, men and women?
So first, we've talked about how to manage your communication, yes. Your expectations. Yes. So you're managing it, but you need to communicate that to your partner. Communication is an art. And if it's an art, then it must be learned. If it must be learned, then the person who must learn must equally apply himself to certain principles of communication. Now, first, you're not going to go to your partner and then you don't care about the pitch. You don't care about what you say. Johnny, I'm so disappointed in this relationship. You are in trouble. Joseph, or Joe, I'm so worried. I think I'm not moving forward. And this marriage didn't bless my life. The first is this. Do not make a comment that makes your partner feel that he is or she is the cause of your woes. Wow. In other words, don't blame your lack of progress in life on your partner. Right. I married you and I didn't grow. Mm-hmm. I married you and I regret that I'm still at where I am. So that's the first thing. First is dissociate the issue from the person. So for example, Joe, we've been married for 7 years now. And the past 7 years has been very interesting. We have had our own successes. We have had our own difficulties. I'm looking forward to add more value to myself. I want to move from where I am to the next level. I don't think I'm seeing that very much in our marriage now. Listen, I didn't say in my marriage now. In our marriage now. Wow. And I'm wondering if we could discuss this. Wow. Do you think that there are some things that I need to do? Do you think that there are some things you need to do? Now, in this presentation mode, you are inviting a conversation over the issue. You are not presenting a complaint. If you present a complaint, what you do is that you dissociate yourself from the matter because you're also contributing. And then you make the person the major object of attack, that you are the reason for which I'm not moving forward. Listen to me, that is wrong. That is wrong. It's a conversation. So look at the mode that I presented that I want us to discuss. So first, have a conversation. And it must be a conversation that doesn't blame the other person. It's a conversation that says, let's sit and talk. That's the first thing. The second way of doing this sometimes will be to invite a friend to the family. See, sometimes I have heard people say, me, when I marry, I don't want a third party. Now, anyone who says he doesn't want a third party, you don't know what marriage is all about. Third parties are part of marriage. But wrong third parties can harm your marriage. So you just need to know who third parties are. Now, Eunice, you are very much aware that when we are going to marry, we marry from families.
Yeah.
So automatically are third parties.
Yes.
Parents are there, your siblings are there, your friends are there. They're third parties. The problem is how do you engage these third parties? And so I have often counseled people and tell them, or couples, and I've told them that invite someone that both trust and you can get into the marriage and say, well, and listen to the presentation again at this time. Well, we invited you in here to help us appreciate what we can do to take our marriage to the next level. You are not asking him to come. Well, I brought you in here to talk to Eunice. Because this marriage, she's the cause of it. She's not making things work. I don't know what to do, so I brought you here. Please talk to her.
Right. Yes.
It's wrong. So the presentation is always, it must always be important, and it must be governed with a sense of decorum, respect, and wisdom.
Right.
And wisdom. So, Joe and I invited you in here. We've been married for 5 years now. A few days ago, we were just having a conversation about what to do with our lives. We discussed issues on expectations and the role of the wife, the husband, how we should take care of the kids, what we should be planning, savings and all of those. And we thought that it would be good to have you in here to speak to us. We acknowledge your expertise in this area. And that's why we invited you. See, then you allow the third party, who's a professional and somebody you respect, to speak to the matter from a neutral perspective.
Right.
And by this stage, none of you should have called the guy and done some underground, you know, when you come, I want you to be doing this. I want to be doing that. When you do that, you are not helping matters. So get a third party to come in. The person can help you, for example, communicate what is on your mind. Another important thing that sometimes is very helpful, if you want to communicate this to your partner, is to use other indirect ways. For example, days when the person is in good spirits, birthday, special anniversary, it's been 4 years and we are celebrating our fourth anniversary, 10 years, and Joe, I want to have a heart-to-heart talk with you. And by the time you say a heart-to-heart talk, it means that a presentation should be that cordial, you know, a heart-to-heart talk. Maybe you'd gone out for a holiday, perhaps you have just planned this to be before you make love or maybe after love. And then heart-to-heart talk, the pitch, the tone, the choice of words, it's important. You don't just accost the man. He just returned from work, very tired, very stressed. And as soon as, you sit down. I was meaning to tell you this, but now you are in the house, so let me just put it straight away. I'm not going to mince words. Look, I think that we are not growing. This marriage is not growing. I mean, you can't do that. Come on. You see, Eunice, we need to learn the art of communicating. And part of it is the time to communicate. And what to communicate. And the body language. So if somebody is just communicating to you, listen to this, that our body language, when we communicate to people, And when we are telling people about what to do, our body language enough tells them whether we genuinely are communicating or we just want to push something down their throat.
Right.
I mean, your facial contours, your pitch, your tone, the way you are just, you know, raising your shoulders and what do you want to say by reading all of this? So these are some of the principles of communicating this to your partner. The Akan Bible, I've forgotten the scripture, but it says, Mbuayenya sankai abufu, a gentle response will always avert anger. Mbuayenya sankai abufu. So it's always important to just, I read that scripture for you, and I think I should read it again, James 1:19. Let's see that. I like that text so much. James 1:19-20. If you get that, you can read. James 1:19. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to be angry. Slow to speak, and slow to be angry. And look at Proverbs 10:19. Proverbs 10:19. Maybe we can add 20 and 21. It says, sin is not ended by multiplying words. In other words, in a multitude of words, there will be sin. Then it says, but the prudent hold their tongues. 20 says, the tongue of the righteous is choice silver, but the heart of the wicked is a little of value. 21 says, the lips of the righteous nourish many, but fools die for lack of sense. This is straightforward, right? Let me read James 3:3-6. Look at that, James 3:3-6. It says, when we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal. Or take ships as an example. Although they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boast. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. 6 says, the tongue also is a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole body, sets the whole course of one's life on fire, and is itself set on fire by hell. So what you say and how you say it, Jesus says, guard what you say and how you say it. So these are some of the principles and ways of communicating what you have to say to your partner.
Wow, these are deep, deep, deep nuggets. I hope you are learning something, because I surely am. Okay, so Prof, the marriage scene over the years has changed. It has evolved. You know, I mean, in the past, in our grandmother's time, even in I don't remember, who was it that a servant was sent to find a wife for?
Abraham
sent his servant. So, I mean, the marriage has changed. How people find wives, how people find partners. It's changed over the years. Even today, people find partners over the internet. You hear people say, we met on Facebook, we met Instagram. What are the things that people looked out for in the past that has changed today? What are young people looking out for in marriage, really?
Okay, thank you very much. So in the past, when you look at the sociology of marriage and the changing patterns of mate selection, one of the things that comes strong to you is that in the past, parents were very much more interested in being part of the choices you make,
right,
or the choice you make. So parents are likely to, for example, look at potentially somebody who looks healthy, somebody whose background is not fraught with certain supposed cases. They want to be sure you come from a family with moral values. They want to also be sure that you come from a family they know. We know this family, they have very good moral values and all of those. They will do all their underground work and be sure that their daughter is marrying into a family. And the understanding is that marriage is a union between two families. And so families may not want another family to influence them in a very bad way. Also, the consideration to look out for somebody who is healthy was also very deep. Because remember those days, we didn't have mechanized ways of farming. So you had to rely on the raw energies of getting more children, healthy children, you know, to work on the farm. And so your parents are very much also interested in making sure you get into a family where they are healthy. They don't have any track record of maybe giving birth to children with congenital effect and stuff like that. Okay. Parents were also very much interested in looking out for certain indications and indices of, let's say, somebody who has had problems in their marriage, suicide, background, are they in a history like that? And they would do all kinds of thorough research. Well, things have changed. People are now meeting their partners on various social media handles. And then they exchange words here and there. Well, where do you come from? I come from here. So the world is becoming truly a global village where we're meeting people from north and south and relating as if we knew each other years ago. But you see, the fact that the world is becoming a small place doesn't mean when you are making a choice, you don't consider certain things. And let me just walk you through some of the factors that are influencing the choices we are making. So the world has changed. Parents don't seem to have the strong, you know, role in making choices for their awards again. By the time they get to secondary school, they're already making choices. Well, secondary school is being far-fetched. Maybe when they get to JHS, there are many people who said, I met my partner in JHS. Wow, you are doing well to meet your partner in JHS. And some say even primary school. So people are making choices. Whenever in primary school, in JHS, in secondary school, in the university, or at their workplace and whatnot. But there are a few things that we need to be aware of. First is that people are making choices driven by material considerations. So I call that materialization of love or commoditization of love. So, you know, the guy can buy me this. I got the iPhone 12 Pro Max or iPhone 13. I got this. You know, he gave me a nice place to stay. He paid for this for me. He paid my school fees. That is materializing your choice and love. Now, the choice you're making is driven by love. And so if you say that you're making a choice because of what a person has, you are materializing your love. That's one. The second is a commoditization and sexualization of the female body or the male's body. So I want a woman who has boobs, who has back, who has a very slender, you know, waist, and has a long hair, he has so-and-so eyes. As we move on, you would understand that those are not good considerations for marriage at all. Now, I am also not underrating the fact that you must look for somebody whom you are attracted to. I mean, if you are attracted to the person, why not? But I'm saying that those are not enduring qualities, and we'll come to that. So we are commoditizing and sexualizing our choices. And I've met somebody who will tell me that I want a woman who is very chocolate and dark. So if I don't get a lady who is chocolate, who is dark, I'm not marrying. I've met somebody who tells me that I want a woman who is fair. So he hasn't met any fair lady, and so he's not marrying. I've met a woman who will tell me I want a gentleman with six packs. He needs to be bulky, tall. If he's not taller than me, I will not marry. And people are looking at certain demographic features, and they are commoditizing these things. And so some guys will just go on various social media handles and take semi-nude pictures. Ladies are also doing the same thing. You have I have a slender waist. I have a lot of back. I have boobs. I have this. I have that. So you are marriage material. And this is what is on social media now. That is the other consideration. Then the next consideration is to sacralize what I call sacralization of attraction. You see, people feel like when I feel attracted, these days people are talking about soul ties. And soul ties, you know. And as soon as I met him, our souls were yoked together. What kind of yoking is that? You have to be careful. You cannot be yoked just like I met someone and we're yoked together. And others will go to the extent of exchanging blood. Wow. And they just prick each other's finger and then they exchange their blood together because there is this soul tie. You know, wherever I go to, I feel this strong urge to listen. Let us not be sacralizing this kind of attraction. You see, attraction is there. You can be attracted to somebody based on a person's features. Let me tell you a few things that can make you be attracted. You can be attracted because of competence. See, and women oftentimes are attracted to men who are competent in what they do. The guy is very smart in doing things, and because women often want problems solved. And once the man comes her way and the man appears competent, he can be attracted to the. Whereas men get attracted by physical features, women are looking at competence. You can be attracted by similarities because you have ideas together, you share thoughts together, you are attending the same program, your goals seem to, you know, bond. Anytime you are talking, you can see that we are naked mentally on so many things that can attract you. You can be attracted because of familiarity. This time it's not similarity, it's familiarity because you are in the same church, you come from the same background, the same ethnicity, race, all of this can lead to attraction, you know. So please don't sacralize this, make it look like a certain thing is we are bonded together. What happens to you when a person dies? You know, if your soul is tied together, then your soul is really tied together. So we are over sacralizing that. And so as soon as somebody says, I'm attracted, it's like a certain obsession, a certain bond, and they feel so addicted to the bad. They don't know what to do. And they tell you, you know, I don't know, but I can't seem to set myself free. That is a bizarre feeling. And it doesn't help. You see, when you become bonded that way, and you are sacralizing this kind of attraction. So a lot of young ladies are missing out on good guys. Because people will tell you, it's not there. Because they are making a choice based on attraction. It's not there. What is not there? The feeling. Wow. The feeling? Eunice, let's learn this. Human feelings are also sometimes propelled by hormones and chemicals. It's the reason why sometimes when people have certain illnesses, for example, when you get, if you develop diabetes, and you develop diabetes gangrene, and you have some part of your body taken off, and then your nerves not functioning well. When you have your feet at a place where you can't feel anything, there's no sensation. There's no sensation. And you can be seriously injured because you don't feel anything. So such feelings have adaptive, you know, function, but because they're not working, you may be severely injured. So emotions and feelings can be driven by hormones. So let's be careful to say, you know, I don't have the feelings. I don't have the feelings, so I'm not going forward. It's a wrong way to make a choice. But unfortunately, a lot of young ladies, a lot of young men these days are making choices based on feelings, on attraction. You know, I feel strongly attracted and I can't let go. And in my experience for the past 20 years working as a psychologist, I've seen that you are in trouble. And because what happens to your feelings when your feelings now become flat. What happened to the love? Love is not based on feelings. It doesn't grow by just feelings. Love is an attitude. Love is a choice. Love is also driven by rationality. So sit down and think. Don't sit down and feel. Listen, did you hear that?
Yes.
Sit down and think.
Right.
Don't sit down and only feel. And the whole day, you are just, you know, moving in the skies, feeling that this guy, I love this guy so much. I love this lady so much. Oh, my God, I can't sleep. Hey, sister, please sleep small, okay? Ines, brother, sleep small, okay? Please, you need to rest and sleep. You know, so, Ines, this is serious.
Okay.
People cannot sleep the whole night.
Thinking.
Please put on your thinking cap
and
think through. Everything is about feeling, about feeling, about feeling, about feeling. Think through carefully.
Wow.
And so because of feelings, people often don't pray. They are believers, they don't pray. And because of feelings, they don't want to discuss their choices with any adult to give them alternative thought or idea. They don't. Because you see, when you are so obsessed about something and about anybody, you don't entertain contrary perspectives. Because you're obsessed, you like that thing. And contrary perspectives will always make you feel like what you are feeling is bad. So they don't want it. Anybody who says, please, withdraw and, no, I don't want it. Look, that is why the young ladies sometimes will warn their parents, I will kill myself if you don't. What kind of absurd thinking is that? That is just a feeling. And that feeling can really, really affect what is happening. And I think that we need to look at this.
Wow, that is amazing. So stop feeling and start thinking. I hope that we are all putting our thinking caps and our prayer caps on. Alrighty, so like you spoke about parents, you know, not, you know, people that are so obsessed that they do not even want contrary advice. How do I speak to my parents after I have, you know, considered this person and I feel like they're the best person for me? And my parents are so not, you know, they're saying, no, this is, we don't think that this is the person for you. How do I manage such a situation?
And I've had a lot of young people asking me this question. How do I communicate my choice, my love of the man I want to my parents? Because parents sometimes will say, Joe, we don't like this person. Eunice, we don't like that person. And then you are in a fix. Okay. So let's try to appreciate about three things. Number one. You must always have at the back of your mind that every choice you make equally comes with responsibilities and consequences. Oftentimes, people are very enthused, emboldened, strengthened, and willing to just push and make their choice, and they don't think through the consequences. Every choice, positive or negative, has consequences. So your enthusiasm to make a choice must equally be driven by your readiness to accept and admit the impact of my choice. Sometimes your parents have really sat down to think through your choice. And when they ask you questions about why you want to marry the person, you are making comments that are on unenduring factors. For example, you know, that he has money, like the things I mentioned. You have just commoditized the person's body. I mean, look at the body, I like a lady like that. You have just mentioned she comes from a background, the parents have money. You know me, I don't want to marry into a very poor family. You are also sexualizing the body. I mean, these are unenduring qualities. Then your parent will push you to reconsider your decision. Now, we are not saying that this is not good, but your considerations are material. They are ephemeral. They are just, you know, transitory. They are passing. They are not very good reasons. Because, you see, if you say you are marrying somebody because the person has good boobs, he has back. I have seen somebody who had married, and then a year or two after, they have had a surgery, and they have removed one of the breasts. How about that? So look for enduring qualities. So that's the first point, that if your parents are talking to you about enduring qualities that you must consider, then consider that. That's the first thing. But the second part of the whole thing is that your parents must always be aware of what is happening to you. Okay. That it is not good for them to completely ignore your choice, but to challenge you to tell them that I will stand by the consequences of my choice. Come what may. When a child is able to tell me this, I will let it go. Because a child knows the consequences and is ready for it. The only challenge for sometimes for parents is that the child who says he knows the consequences, a few years down the line, is going to be calling on the parent, I can't, I need to come out. And then he places his parents into jeopardy. That is where the issue is. But if you can just tell us that you are ready for it, we don't have a problem. Sometimes, I must admit, parents get it all wrong. There are some parents who are equally materially minded. And they look at their background and they think that where we are heading towards, they are too poor. It doesn't befit their status. How can me at this level allow you to go and condescend so low and pick somebody from this angle? And that's a mistake. You see, when two clean-minded, consenting adults say that we want to embark on this day because of homosexuality, we have to talk about heterosexual marriages. God-sanctioned marriage. You need to let the person be aware that they are making a decision. And the decision that they are making is always important that you inform them to be very much aware and be committed to what they want to do and not to threaten them that whatever happens to you, it's your own life. I don't agree with that. Just support them with what they want to do. Support them with what they want to do because it's very disturbing, you know. And that is something we have to importantly, you know, speak about. Then the third thing I want to talk about is when your parent swear that this will never happen in this home. If this happens, then you need to quickly let the parent be. You have to step in and tell the parent that, look, you cannot do this. You cannot tell the child that this can never happen. Some will say, not on my watch. Some will say, over my dead body. Some will say that, no, this will never happen because this is a very bad thing. And if it happens, I mean, my destiny and my reputation is in trouble. We don't have to do that. What we need to do as parents, when you think that your child is not listening to you, please, you can pray for your child. And if you also feel that your parents are not listening to you, don't get too worried. Please pray for them. Withdraw a little bit and pray through this. It's always important that you withdraw and pray through it and allow God to lead the way. It can help you.
Wow. My final question and then your final words. So having said all these, what should we really look out for?
What should we be looking out for when we are going into? To make it simple, look for enduring qualities. I'm going to mention some of them. Does the person fear the Lord? People who fear God are almost all the time ready to make amends when they make mistakes. And that's what you need. A partner who is ready to make amends when he makes mistakes. Number two, look for somebody with a group mindset. A group mindset says that the person is not idiosyncratic, not opinionated. He doesn't shift his mind on anything. You can't get to his heart. It's so hard to convince. You don't need somebody like that. Is the person very opinionated? That's not too good. It's a red flag. Is he very idiosyncratic? Not too good. It's a red flag. So somebody who has an open mind and is ready to converse with you, to engage you in talking through the issues. Number three, you need somebody who respects who you are. Your color, your height, your race, your ethnicity, wherever you come from. Does he respect you along these lines? Number four, don't let anybody marry you out of compassion and out of sympathy. You know, Eunice, I've just thought through you and thought through the matter, and I think that if I don't marry you, nobody will marry you. And I just want to marry you. No. When you marry out of compassion, your choice is weak. You should never make a choice driven by compassion. If you don't want, you don't want. So you need to make a choice based on rationality and prayerfulness, not on compassion or sympathy. Another thing to be very much aware of is to make a choice by looking at the person's background carefully. You see, we think that background checks are not good. But I think that in the age and times we are in, background checks are extremely important. You know why? Because people can just present themselves as angel of light on social media and various platforms. He comes in there very neat, very nice, and you know it than I do, that they can present themselves looking very attractive. And yet, there are a lot of artificialities in there. You don't know where the person comes from. Nobody can ever tell me that I just met this guy online and we haven't yet known each other's family, but we are in love. What's wrong with you? You cannot be in love with a stranger just like that. You need to find out where the person comes from. Get to know the person. Get to know the person's family. Listen, anybody who does not want you to know who he or she is not a partner. Let me put it that blunt, is not a partner. So on that note, I've shared some principles with you. I hope these are very helpful. And listen to me carefully, ladies and gentlemen. I hope that these principles will help you in you making choices in life. By the way, remember that the choices you make in life can affect your destiny. It can break your life. It can make you. People have made choices and their lives have been enhanced. They have also made choices and lives have been very difficult for them. I pray for you that you will apply yourself to these principles that we have shared with you. In all of this, remember that God is the lifter up of our heads. And so remember that if Jesus is in your life, everything shall go on well. If you're not born again, just look at me and say these words after me. Dear Father, thank you for Jesus. Today, I acknowledge I'm a sinner. I confess Jesus as my Lord and personal Savior. I will love him and serve him all the days of my life. So help me, God. If you pray this prayer, you are born again. Look at all our social media handles and follow through and get to us. We'll help you grow your faith in Christ Jesus. If you are far away from us, just go to any Bible-believing church and it will help you grow your Christian life. And we'll come your way same time next week. This is Anchor Hour, brought to you from Rhema Worship Center of the Church of Pentecost, located at Champo Junction, East Legon. Same time next week, 12 o'clock to 1 p.m. Shalom, peace, and life to you. Bye-bye.